Did you know that underwater structures have lower natural frequencies compared to those in air? Hello, this is Armin. Welcome to my channel. In this video, I'll show you how to calculate the natural frequencies of a beam both underwater and in air using acoustic-structure interaction physics with appropriate boundary conditions. Let's begin by discussing the model. When a solid structure like a beam is submerged in a fluid such as water, the surrounding fluid introduces additional inertial and damping forces. These effects significantly alter the system's dynamic response, notably leading to a reduction in natural frequencies. In this tutorial, we will investigate a submerged cantilever beam in water and air. This expression calculates the analytical natural frequencies. In water, the beam's effective mass increases due to added mass, which decreases the natural frequency of the beam. We will investigate the behavior of a submerged cantilever beam in water. When the beam is submerged, the surrounding water adds to its effective mass, which in turn lowers its natural frequencies according to this expression. We'll use the pressure acoustics and solid mechanics physics interfaces in COMSOL. The fluid will be set as water and air, while the beam is made of steel. The study type is eigenfrequency, which allows us to extract natural frequencies and their corresponding mode shapes. That's the overview. Let's get started. First, I'll click on Model Wizard. Since we're working with a 3D geometry, I'll select 3D as the space dimension. From the list of physics interfaces, we need to couple acoustics with solid mechanics, so I'll expand the acoustics branch. Here, I'll select Acoustic Structure Interaction Frequency Domain and click Add. Now we have both pressure acoustics and solid mechanics coupled in the model. Next, I'll go to the study section. Since we want to perform a modal analysis, I'll select eigenfrequency and click Done. Now we can proceed to the next step, which is building the geometry. I'll right-click on geometry and select Block. This will represent the fluid domain, so I'll rename it to Fluid. Under Size and Shape, I'll set the dimensions to 1 meter by 0.5 meter by 0.5 meter, then click Build All Objects. Now it's time to add a beam to the model, which requires a work plane. I'll right-click on Geometry 1 and select Work Plane. To place the work plane on the left side of the block, I'll change the type from Quick to Face Parallel, and then select the mentioned surface. Next, I'll go to Work Plane 1, open Plane Geometry, and choose the Rectangle tool from the Sketch tab. To create a base for the beam, I'll start by drawing a rectangle. I'll draw a square at the center of the plane and then adjust its dimensions. In the Size and Shape section, I'll set the width and height to 0.08 meters and adjust the position to minus 0.04 meters. Then, I'll click Build Selected. As you can see, the square is now centered in the geometry. To give it volume, I'll right-click on the work plane and choose Extrude. I'll set the extrusion distance to 0.05 meters and then click Build All Objects again. I have to check the reverse direction and click Build All Objects again. Now, if we make the geometry transparent, we can see the base inside the block domain. I like to add a beam to the base, so I'll insert another work plane from the Geometry tab. I will change the work plane type from Quick to Face Parallel and select the face where I want the beam to be placed. Next, I'll go to Plane Geometry, and in the Sketch tab, I'll choose the Rectangle tool to define the cross-section of the beam. To define the dimensions, I'll set the height to 0.02 meters and adjust the position to center it on the base. This centers the beam on the base. Now let's extrude the beam. I'll right-click on Work Plane 1 and choose Extrude. Since half a meter is sufficient for the extrusion, I'll set the distance to 0.5 meters and click Build All Objects. The geometry is now complete. Next, we need to add material. I'll right-click on Materials and select Add Material from Library. Since the beam is made of structural steel, I'll expand the built-in material section and locate structural steel. Once I select it, I'll click Add to Component. All domains are selected by default, so I'll start by deselecting them and selecting only the solid parts. Next, I need to assign a material to the block domain, which represents the fluid. I'll choose liquid water from the material library and then close the material window. Now, I can assign water to the block domain. You'll notice a red cross next to the material icon, which indicates that the physics settings are not properly defined. To fix this, I'll go to Pressure Acoustics. Currently, all domains are selected, but we only want to apply this physics to the fluid domain, so I'll deselect all domains and choose just the fluid block. Next, I'll adjust the solid mechanics settings. Again, I'll deselect all domains and select only the base and beam domains. Now, let's return to the material section. The red cross has disappeared, indicating that the physics interfaces are now correctly assigned. I want to perform a modal analysis to find the natural frequency of the beam and water, so I need to define a boundary condition for solid mechanics. I'll right-click on the solid mechanics interface and choose Fix Constraint. The beam root is fully constrained, so I'll select this face as the fixed boundary. We don't need to apply any additional boundary conditions. Now, I'll switch to the Pressure Acoustics interface. By default, all boundaries are treated as rigid walls. However, the top surface represents a free surface, so we must apply a zero pressure condition there. To do this, I'll right-click on the Pressure Acoustics node, select Pressure, and assign it to the top surface. The physics interfaces are now fully defined. Let's move on to the mesh. I'll navigate to Mesh 1 and change the maximum element size, setting from Study to Frequency. Since the eigenfrequency study doesn't require a frequency range, I'll enter 1000 Hz as the reference frequency. Then, I'll click Build All to generate the mesh. Now we're ready to compute the solution. In the study step, I'll specify that we want to find 15 eigenfrequencies. Then I'll click Compute. The solution has been completed successfully. In the data subsection, we can see the computed natural frequencies. These frequencies include both acoustic and structural modes. To clearly identify the acoustic modes, we need to run a structural modal analysis without the fluid domain. To do this, I'll navigate to the Study tab and add a new study. In the Physics and Study settings, I'll disable the Pressure Acoustics and Acoustic Structure Boundary interfaces and then choose an eigenfrequency study. This way, only the solid mechanics physics will be included in the solution. I'll close the window, go back to the study section, and click Compute. The solution has been completed successfully. Let's take a look at the natural frequencies. The first natural frequency is approximately 64 Hz, which corresponds to the structure in a vacuum. To keep things organized, It's a good idea to rename the result labels to distinguish between the natural frequencies in water and in vacuum. As you can see, the mode shape in water is 54.70 Hz, which is lower than the natural frequency in vacuum. Now, let's move on to the second natural frequency. In water, it drops to around 232 Hz, while in vacuum, it's about 236 Hz. Water slightly alters the mode shapes. For the third mode, the frequency is approximately 343 Hz in water and 401 Hz in vacuum. All natural frequencies are lower in water due to the added mass effect from the fluid. Let's check the other natural frequencies. As you can see, all natural frequencies in water are lower than those in vacuum. At this point, it's a good idea to save the model. Next, let's change the fluid domain from water to air. I'll right-click on Materials, select Air, and close the material window. Then, I'll assign air to the block domain and disable the water material. Now, I'll recompute study 1. The solution is complete. Let's check the results. The first natural frequency remains around 64 Hz. It's better to update the label name from water to air to keep the results clear. As you can see, there's only a small difference between the natural frequencies in air and vacuum. The natural frequencies in air and vacuum are nearly identical. In vacuum, the second natural frequency is about 236 Hz. In air, it's about 170 Hz, which indicates an acoustic mode. The third natural frequency in air is 236 Hz. Matching the vacuum frequency. We can conclude that the presence of air has minimal impact on the natural frequency, while water significantly lowers it due to its higher density. That wraps up the tutorial. If you found it helpful, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more content like this. Thanks for watching.